Welcome back. If you're just joining us, you're watching Ministry Now. Rachel and I are so glad that you are here. We really believe that today's show is going to bless you. Well, there is transformational power in having a mission that guides our life, which our guests speak into in their newest book, Your Mission in God's Army. As a dynamic duo, literally the dynamic duo, their accomplishments consist of being a decorated military chaplain and a Pulitzer Prize nominated journalist. Please welcome Colonel David Giammona and Troy Anderson.
Yay!
Welcome to
Daystar,
Colonel.
Thank you, sir.
Good to see you.
Thank you.
Thanks for being here.
Thanks
for coming. Good to see you. Welcome.
We're so happy to have you with us.
And it is great to be back.
It's been a while since you guys have been here.
Yeah, absolutely.
We've got to have you back more often.
Absolutely.
You know, last night I was going through your book, Your Mission in God's Army.
Yeah.
And I believe that in the times we are living in right now, a book like this is going to be pivotal and it's going to be such a blessing. But before we start, for those that may have, you know, might need a refresher on essentially, why should people listen to two people about talking about getting in God's army? You were in the army for 32 years.
Correct.
Oversaw people all around the world in your chaplaincy role.
Absolutely.
So decorated officer, you've won so many different medals and awards. I mean, the list is just long. So I think that speaks volumes. Like when you speak, you're talking from knowledge and experience, yeah?
Right. When you have people shooting at you at war, you get firsthand experience of what war is really like. And so when we wrote this book, not only was I in war, but I was in the assignments officer for the chief of chaplains for the entire Army Chaplain Corps.
Wow.
So for 4 years, I assigned people. And the how I assigned them was, what were they like? What was in their DNA? What kind of experiences have, and could they do the assignment they're about to do? And so we transferred all that into this book.
Wow. And Troy, you've worked for so many different national and global organizations that the world listens to from a journalistic perspective, and you've been a Pulitzer nominated award journalist. So you've had all this experience on the media side as well, which speaks volumes. So it's like two extremely qualified, highly skilled, highly celebrated people coming together to write a book.
Oh, yeah, it's just an incredible honor to team up with the Colonel on your mission in God's Army. You know, I was a reporter at the LA Daily News for many years. I was an editor of Charisma Magazine and just, you know, different publications. So this is a great honor to bring this message to the Daystar audience.
Okay, so this is y'all's third book together, am I right?
Correct.
Tell us the story of how you guys came together or even, you know, made this connection to start writing these books.
It's all supernatural. It's a God thing. 2018, I'm about to retire. So I say, okay, God, what's next? And God speaks to me in a vision and said, you're to prepare the church and warn the world. I start writing a book called The Making of a Warrior. And I know I need help. And I've not been in the publishing business and editing business. And the first thing that pops up on my computer screen in my office in the Army is Troy Anderson on my LinkedIn page. I call him. I said, Troy, what do you think about this? And he said, well, let me talk about to my wife and to the Lord and I'll get back to you. Mm-hmm. And the rest is history.
Wow.
So I know a lot of people right now probably experiencing some uncertain feelings. The world seems to be going crazy. You've been in physical wars, Colonel. Are we in a war right now that perhaps people don't understand, that we're in a spiritual and physical war right now?
I think the spiritual war is much more intense than the physical wars I've ever been into. So it's the powers of darkness are enveloping the world. And as we approach the coming of the Lord, it's only going to get darker. And we wrote this book because not only are we giving people hope, but God says you don't have to fear because if I have called you, I'm the only one who can take you out. So people ask me all the time, were you ever afraid in combat? You bet your booty I was afraid in combat. People shooting at you, you're going to be afraid. But I never took counsel of my fears. And today, the Lord is saying, don't take counsel of your fear. Yes, things are not good, dark world and all that, but I have overcome the world. You know, the Lord said, many are the tribulations of the righteous, but I have overcome them all. So there we are.
So we're living in, you know, you heard us talk to Joseph Z. There's been all these signs of the time. Do you think it's significant that your book is coming out just a few days after this eclipse? I mean, maybe a little God wink?
Oh yeah. I mean, it's absolutely amazing. We didn't time this, but, you know, this eclipse goes through, you know, a number of cities called Nineveh.
Right.
I did this interview with Billy Graham in 2013 for a seven-part WorldNet Daily series. And he said, when God sent the prophet Jonah to Nineveh to warn them of judgment, the king and the people repented. And Billy Graham said, I believe the same thing could happen again, this time in America. So flash forward to, you know, this eclipse on Monday, it goes through all these towns called Nineveh. So we just wrote a story for Charisma, the great North American eclipse, is this America's Nineveh moment? And so I believe, you know, God is calling us to return to him. It's time to turn back to God.
So you think it was a warning sign?
Yeah.
I mean, what are the chances that it would go through so many cities? I mean, who would think that there was even that many cities named Nineveh?
And then, you know, if you take the 2017 eclipse, this one, the last one last year, it forms the Hebrew letters Aleph and Tav, or Alpha and Omega, beginning and the end, the name of Jesus in the last chapter of Revelation stamped across America. I mean, it's absolutely phenomenal.
And there's no way that people could fake that or put it together because, number one, who wants to call their city Nineveh? No offense to anyone who's living in Nineveh. God bless you, and we're sure it's a great place. But, you know, when you're running, it's not going to be a typical. And then to do it across the path of an eclipse, I think it just highlights God really is giving us evidence in the skies.
God has given us warning that judgment is coming. It's already upon us. But it's also it. When Jonah preached in Nineveh, 763 BC, or about that time, there was a great eclipse then. And that's why the people repented. I believe God's given us a 40-day window of repentance. What happens on May 18th, I cannot tell you. But I want to be on the side of God and not the side of Satan or darkness at that point. So we'll see how we progress through the judgments that are coming onto the planet.
That's so interesting, too, because Joseph Z had that same kind of revelation, that prophetic insight, and it's the same thing that you guys are sharing. So we see these kind of same messages and themes throughout the body of Christ. So that's definitely something that we want to watch, pray into, just be led by. So I think that's interesting. I'm curious just your perspective of some of the other like signs of the time and your perspective, especially as a colonel, as far as what's going on in our world with, you know, what happened on October 7th in Israel, the escalations with Iran. There's been a lot of talk of, you know, because Israel killed some of their military commanders of retaliation. How do you see that playing into all of this?
I get asked that a lot and around the world. And I think we really are on the brink of a major conflict, maybe World War III. But if you look at Russia and the Ukraine and then the NATO alliances going on with Finland and Sweden. First time they're preparing for war in 200 years. All of Europe is getting ready. Then we have the Middle East, and then we have China and Taiwan and North Korea. We have a world that's just collapsing in. And Jesus said in Matthew 24, there's going to be wars and rumors of the wars all the way until the end. So global conflict. What's going to happen with Israel? That's the key for everything. We have to keep our eyes on the ball and Jerusalem and Israel and what's going on there. Iran said they're going to attack their embassies, Hezbollah in the north, and they're repositioning their forces right now in Israel to attack Rafah. And so on and on it goes that we are headed, and nothing can stop this.
Right.
It's just we're headed, like it's already written in history. But again, as we say in the book, and we'll talk about that maybe in a moment, we don't have to be afraid, but we must be prepared.
Exactly, because the Bible says my people perish because of lack of knowledge.
Yes.
And so this book really does provide practical things that we can do right now living in these uncertain times. You talk about the four W's. I love the four W's. Could you elaborate on that?
The colonel's an expert on that.
Well, the four W's is what everybody asks. Why am I here? What is my purpose? Where am I going? And so we'll elaborate on all the W's, but the purpose of why we're here, we're made in the image of God. Whether you're a Christian watching this show or a non-Christian, you have purpose. God has purposed you for something. And so we wrote this book to show people that God has a plan, a purpose. If you accept Jesus Christ, you get into the God's army, and then you really begin to understand your purpose. And then why are we here? There's only one reason why we're here. We're here to worship the Lord Jesus Christ, be made in His image, and bring everybody we can into the kingdom before the glory of the Lord appears in the end times.
And I think that's the hope that we all have, because we've got Jesus. Those of us who have invited Jesus into our heart, we can live in that peace. We can see the turmoil, but we can have that peace that surpasses all understanding. And if there's someone watching right now, there's never a better time than right now to accept Jesus as your Lord. If you're missing that peace, if you don't know where you're going, if you feel like you don't have that purpose, you find that in Jesus when you ask Him into your life. And it's a simple thing to do. All you have to do is to say, Father God, come into my heart. I'm sorry for my wrongs. I'm sorry for my sins. I turn away from that and I choose You to be Lord of my life. Come on into my heart. Be Lord and Savior. In Jesus' name, amen. And you know, while you're at it, you should also invite the Holy Spirit to fill you, because Acts 1:8 says, you receive power when the Holy Spirit comes upon you. What does power mean? That means power to overcome fear, power to overcome anxiety, power to walk in the joy of the Lord, because the joy of the Lord will be your strength. So the Holy Spirit is the great helper, and He was sent by Jesus went to heaven so the Holy Spirit could come down. And so all you have to do is just say, Holy Spirit, fill my life. I invite You in. Give me ears to hear what You're saying and eyes to see what You're doing, and give me the strength to obey. You know, if you prayed either of those prayers with us, we'd love to send you the book of John. It is a fantastic book. You know, it's got QR codes in there that show you links that you can get more and more information. And we've just put this together to be a blessing for you. We don't want anything from you. All we want to do is bless you and encourage you in the walk. So those that now have Jesus, there's no fear in any of this, is there?
No, there isn't. And what we have to understand as believers in Jesus Christ, we are eternal, even right now. And as people ask me, were you ever afraid in combat and bullets flying? I said, look, I am immortal and eternal. And if God chooses to send me home, then He will. But He's got a plan and purpose for all of us. And until we're finished with that plan, He's not taking us home.
Yeah.
But if He's ready to take us home, we will go that direction.
I love that you are infusing your military knowledge and experience into this book. From a military perspective, you were in the actual army, but we're in God's army. And there's a lot to glean from your experience. And you break the book up into four parts. And I want to kind of just highlight each part and give a little synopsis of it. So the first part that you break it into is the mission. What's our mission?
Right. Our mission, first of all, as you just prayed, is to get into the army, get into the kingdom. And as we're all believers who are watching right now, our mission is to, you see, people have to understand, believers in Jesus Christ, that we can hear the Holy Spirit. He is speaking to us. And prayer is a powerful weapon. And our mission is to listen to our commander in chief and get His orders for our lives. So a lot of people say, I don't know what I'm supposed to do. Well, then get on your face before the Lord and don't leave there until you know that you know that you know what God is calling you to do, because you are designed for a purpose. You have a mission, and the mission is sent through in the Holy Spirit of our hearts. And then it's, you know, we speak that mission every day. So my mission, He gave me two missions, prepare the church and warn the world. And He's given me platforms to do it. But everybody's important, behind the cameras, behind the scenes, everywhere. And people ask me, well, what's the most important job in the army? Well, the most important job is what God has assigned you in the army. And in the physical army, there are, you know, you could be a rifleman, infantry, artillery, and all of that. But that's not the important job. If you don't have beans and bullets and you don't have food and you don't have the supply, it's not going to happen.
Right.
Everybody's important in this army.
We're all playing a small part in a bigger picture, and it's important that we know the part that we play. And so getting alone with the Lord, saying, Lord, what is it that You want me to do? Figuring out Your unique calling and purpose, and then listening and obeying what He's called us to do. So the mission's the first part, and then the second, the faith walk.
Yes, the faith walk is part of the mission. mission. So a lot of times God gives us a mission. He called me in the Army, and the only thing he said to me audibly, I'm sitting there in Camp Pendleton in a Marine Corps boot camp, 1985. He says, you're going in the military. He didn't say which part of the military. He didn't say what I was going to do. That's the faith walk. Every moment, every day, it's a faith journey. It's not a one-time thing. Okay, I accept Jesus Christ and that's it. No, it's a journey of faith. And the faith is listening to the Holy Spirit, to what the Lord is saying us, and stepping out in faith. It's not going to be easy. It's sometimes very difficult. But through that process, God grows us. Through the process, God grows us in that faith journey.
So for figuring out the mission, the faith walk, and then future strategies.
Future strategy is, so in the Army, I went to Army War College.
Right.
And they plan all kinds of contingency operations around the world. What are we going to do here and what are we going to do there? Our future strategy is based on one thing, the word of the living God. And so God has a strategy. You know, all these signs that we're seeing in the end times, it's part of a strategy. And God is saying, okay, I'm warning you. I'm giving you fair warning. I'm showing you all the things that are happening. That's God's strategy. And in our life, God has a strategy that he's going to unfold. We have to follow that plan by listening to the voice of the Holy Spirit in our lives.
And in the book, you dig deeper in showing people how to apply those things to their life so they can do these three steps. But the fourth one I really like about the skill set that God's given us. Can you unpack that?
Every one of us has a DNA package inside of us that God has put in that we are destined to fulfill. DNA is really important in life because it kind of tells us, I'm never going to be an NBA player. Okay. I'm past age anyway. But I'm never going to. There's a lot of things. I'm not going to be a doctor. I'm not going to be a lawyer. But God has given me a DNA to speak. I'm also a musician and to write and to do those things that God has called me. What is God in calling you in your DNA? What is your passion? When you wake up in the morning, what is it that God has placed in you? That's the strategy and that's the DNA package that God has placed in all of us. And so there is nobody left outside of that. All of us have divine purpose. All of us have a divine plan. And a lot of people are fearful and they're afraid of what's going to happen. There's no need to be that way because we can follow the divine plan, a divine path in our lives.
Colonel, one of the things I love about your book is just how simple you make it, how simple both of you unpack it, because these are really big, hard questions. I mean, people are freaking out right now. But it really is simple when you follow the biblical plan and you follow these simple steps, which actually are big steps, but they're simple. Everybody can do what is outlined in this book. Is that right?
No, and that's right. I don't care what education level you have. And you may come from the poorest family. You can come through all kinds of different scenarios. But God can take you out of where you are and place you where you need to be. But if you just have to follow that plan. And the other thing is a lot of people, even believers, don't read their Bibles anymore. Mm-hmm. They don't have a biblical worldview. I'm encouraging people, and Troy and I have written this book, to get, there's a lot of scriptures in here, get back into the biblical, into the Word of God, and apply these principles into your life. And that's what is the simple thing. Get the Word of God and start living the Word of God.
Yeah, because the Word of God never returns void. When you apply it, when you live it, it never returns void. And it is the power. It is the power because it's the Word of God. Well, you know, I think now's a great time to sing this new song called Worth. And it really, you know, it talks about what you're saying. And that is that every single person has value, has a God-given destiny that God came to die for. Mm-hmm. That makes every single human being on this planet so precious. We pray this song blesses you. It's called Worth.
You thought I was worth saving, so you came and changed my life. You you clean me up inside. You thought I was to die for, so you sacrificed your life so I could be free, so I could be whole, so I can tell.
Tune for more from David Giammona and Troy Anderson next.
Whenever you need it.
Oh, you're the king now.
whatever it is, we are here for you.
Wow, what a great song. I just feel the presence of God here, and I'm just reading through all these different prayer requests that have been sent in, Rachel, and I just want to encourage people, that number on the bottom of the screen, 1-800-329-0029, that's for you. Mm-hmm. And as Dr. Doug says a lot, put it in your phone, because you never know when you're gonna need someone that you can just call on the spot and pray for a breakthrough, for protection. Or you might be still wanting to pray that prayer of salvation because you were worth saving. Mm-hmm. Jesus died for you, so you don't have to live in these times feeling insecure or fearful. So, Troy, going back to the book, you made a distinction between a secular job or sacred. And you said that it was kind of a bit of a trap for Christians to think that one particular job might be more sacred than another.
Yeah, there's no difference between the sacred and the secular in God's kingdom. You know, my great-grandfather, Frederick von Schiller, wrote the poem Ode to Joy that Beethoven set to music in the Ninth Symphony. He said, there's no such thing as chance, that even the merest accident springs from the deepest source of destiny. So the Bible tells us that from the foundations of the world, God planned out all our lives. He has an incredible mission, incredible assignments, a destiny for all of us, and he wants us to walk into that. So no matter where you find yourself in life, God is preparing you for your next mission, your next assignment, and he has amazing things planned for your life, a miracle, supernatural journey that only he can devise because he's the creator of the universe.
And he's got that for every single person. Not one person misses out on this if they're a believing Christian, a follower of Christ, yeah?
Yeah, that's the key. You got to give your life to Jesus, dedicate your life completely to him, and then he'll lead you into that amazing assignment he has for your life.
Yeah, that's amazing. Colonel, you've served several active duties overseas. You were in Iraq, Afghanistan, where else?
Afghanistan and then
Saudi Arabia.
Kuwait.
So you learned, I'm sure, a thing or two about being a good soldier. What lessons did you take from the military of learning how to be a good soldier to apply that to being a good soldier in God's army?
That is a great question. So when we have people come off the bus for the first time that want to be soldiers, the first thing we do is tell them, throw your bag that you brought with you, throw it in this pile because you're not going to need it anymore. Get rid of all your baggage.
Wow.
And we're not going to just hand you a rifle in basic training. We're going to train you. So what I learned is that pastors, Christians, people in church have to be trained in the kingdom, in the doctrine of the army as we are soldiers, and the doctrine of the Bible. And so understanding that it's a process, a lifelong learning process of learning how to use the weapons of our warfare, of learning to read the Word of God and understand it and give our testimony. So there's a great deal of parallels between the military and the kingdom of God.
Yeah, you talk about that kind of tension between faith and friction.
Yes.
Like, unpack that a little bit more.
Well, in our life, when we walk in faith, we're going to have friction.
Mm-hmm.
Friction, strength, it's not a bad thing.
Mm-hmm.
Friction is the thing that keeps us going, that makes us depend on God. If we could do it all ourselves, we don't need God. But the friction strengthens us, makes us grow in the grace and knowledge of Jesus Christ. As we walk by faith, we will run into obstacles, but we will overcome those obstacles by the blood of the Lamb and the word of our testimony.
Mm-hmm. Troy, what would you say to someone who's watching that says, I love everything that you're saying. I want to be a soldier in God's army, but I don't know how. Maybe they're scared. Maybe they're afraid. Maybe they feel ill-equipped or they don't know what their gifts and talents are. What would be some practical advice for them to go along this journey?
Yeah, so what I'd say is that the first thing is just pray. Ask the Lord to show you what your assignment is, what your mission is, how you can join God's army, and then, you know, start delving into the Word of God. Ask the Holy Spirit to transform your mind, you know, bind your mind to Christ, and then slowly over time, the Lord will show you what your assignment is. He'll train you, he'll prepare you for it, and, you know, he has incredible things in store for all of us. If we just simply dedicate our lives completely to him, give him 110%.
That is so cool. So, Colonel, right before we pray for the people who have called in, and by the way, keep on calling that number, 0029. We'd love to pray with you. And even after the show, we're still going to print these out and our team is still going to pray. We never stop praying 24/7 here at Daystar. That's one of the things that Joni has instilled here. Actually, it was all the way back to Marcus. Mm-hmm. We wanted to make that a free service for people.
Prayer and the power of the Holy Spirit, which I was thinking about this the whole time that we've been talking about how that's such a secret weapon. You know, when we're in the Lord's army, that the Lord has given us is the power of the Holy Spirit. And I was wondering if you guys could share a little bit of your journey of faith and receiving the Holy Spirit in your own life and how you've used that in your journey of faith.
Well, you know, when I was saved in 1974, way back. I prayed for 4 months after I was saved to receive the power of the Holy Spirit. I don't think we ever should stop receiving and renewing our faith every day. And then 4 months later, the Lord gave me a dream. In the dream, He pointed to me. He was in the desert and I was climbing the mountain and I was filled with the Holy Spirit in this dream. And the next day, I was actually baptized in the Holy Spirit. So we should always seek the power of God every day. And when people talk about renewal and revival, you know, I need a shower every day. I need a renewal every day because the world just clings on to me. I need to be revived every day. And we need the power and the provision and protection of the Holy Spirit every moment, every day. It's not something I want to be without. And God has gifted it to us. He said, wait in Jerusalem in the book of Acts, chapter 1, and to receive the power. Wait on God is a secret of really going forth in the power of God.
Amen. Troy, your thoughts?
I just recall while we're working on this book, my wife became very ill and she was hospitalized for 17 days. She had severe COVID pneumonia, severe sepsis, acute pancreatitis, stomach bleeding. Doctor told me she only had a 50-50 chance of living. So I asked our Battle Ready Ministries team to pray for her, our small group, and God intervened and saved her life. Then we got this gigantic hospital bill. Now, Lord, how am I ever going to pay this thing? And so we submitted our tax returns, all our assets, the whole thing. And I thought, maybe they'll drop it by 25%, maybe 50%. And they forgave the entire bill.
Wow.
So this is like, you know, when you dedicate your life to the Lord, you'll see these gigantic miracles that God performs. And He'll take us through whatever the future holds.
Yes. And God just doesn't do it for one or two people. Mm-hmm. God makes that available to everybody. And, you know, just before the singers sing this final song, would you gentlemen like to pray for these precious people who have sent in prayer requests for breakthrough, for healing, finances, guidance during these times?
Father, in the mighty name of Jesus Christ, you know all things. You know the beginning from the end. There is nothing too difficult for you. For every one of these needs, Father, right now, we ask for your intervention, for finances, for healing, for salvation, for blessing, for relationship restoration, for whatever needs are in here, Lord. You know them all better than anybody in this universe because you created us in your image in the Imago Dei. And Lord, we lift them up right now in the mighty name of Jesus, asking for divine intervention. Yes. And we're going to believe it done for everyone here because you don't play favorites and we'll thank you for it in advance in the mighty name of Jesus Christ.
Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Thank you so much for coming. And you know, we just thought that we'd close out today's show with a special song that we know is going to bless you. It's called Overflow of Worship. And we just want you to soak in the presence of God. And remember, God loves you and God is for you.